Good afternoon and a very warm welcome to St Mary's. It's not often we talk about a warm welcome here, but today does seem to fit the bill. So it's a great pleasure to have you all with us here today as we gather to mark the rededication of the restored Walker organ. Especially good to welcome the Lord Mayor and Lady Mayoress, and to welcome Bishop Jonathan, who will be carrying out the rededication and blessing of the organ in a very short service. In case you're sitting there and wondering, well, I haven't got an order of service, you have. It's in the programme, and it is the second page of the programme, all set out for you. There are parts for you to sing, parts for you to say, and to share in as far as you are able, this wonderful celebration. We'll explain more of what happens after that at the end of the service. So we stand for the first hymn, Angel Voices Ever Sing.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the Lord, whose praises are sung by the saints, be with you all.
And also with you.
It is good to praise the Lord and make music to your name, O Most High.
To proclaim your love in the morning and your faithfulness.
Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come before him and ask him, and show him in his
What a joy it is to gather after so many years of team effort and consummate skill. My dear brothers and sisters, we have come together to give thanks for the restoration of this organ and to rededicate it so that it may enhance our worship with beautiful and solemn tones. The purpose of music in the liturgy is above all to give glory to God and to lead us to holiness. Thus, the music of the organ wonderfully expresses the new song that Scripture tells us to sing to the Lord. To sing this new song is to live rightly, to follow God's will eagerly and gladly, and by loving one another, to carry out the new commandment. Let us first give thanks for those whose craft, skill, and dedication has completed this restoration. Almighty God, whom saints and angels delight to worship in heaven, we give you thanks for your servants who, through their art and craft, have restored this organ. Grant to them now glimpses of your beauty and make them worthy to behold it unveiled forevermore through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Would you please sit?
Let us say the words of Psalm 150. O praise God in his holiness. Praise him in his noble acts. Praise him in the sound of the trumpet. Praise him in the cymbals and dances. Praise him upon the well-tuned cymbals.
And now, bless this organ, we pray, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, that it may be set apart and consecrated for the praise of these things, for the praise of you. These things we ask in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you, O Father, and the Holy Spirit, praise is given forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Our prayers of thanksgiving, the response to let us bless the Lord, is glory to you, O Lord. Let us bless the Lord.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Let us pray, my brothers and sisters, and let us glorify the all-powerful God for his countless blessings. And as St. Paul says, let us give him thanks, singing his praises with hearts and voices. Father, all holy, King of heaven and earth, source of all perfection, inspirer of all sacred music, we praise you for your great glory. Let us bless the Lord.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Lord Jesus Christ, splendor of the Father's glory, you came among us as one of us to take away sin and to enrich the redeemed with your grace. We give you glory for your great mercy. Let us bless the Lord.
Glory to you, O Lord.
God the Holy Spirit, you dwell in our hearts and build us up into the one body of Christ. We honor you for the mystery of your presence in the church. Let us bless the Lord.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Holy Trinity, one God, beginning and end of all things, the heavens and the earth sing a new song to you. We adore you for your unsearchable blessedness. Let us bless the Lord.
Glory to you, O Lord.
So we end our service by standing to sing the hymn, O Praise Ye the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Lord is worthy of all praise. May he give you the gift of striving to sing a new song to him with your voices, your hearts, and your lives, so that one day you may sing that song forever in heaven. And may Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
welcomed you, we promised you we'd explain what will happen next. And that task, I'm delighted to say, falls to me. Firstly, to say a huge thank you to all of you for turning out and joining us on this occasion. It's a wonderful sense of being surrounded by people's support and love and prayers on a day that's very important to us as a parish. I have to say also the singing was stunning. And if you'd like to join us tomorrow afternoon, there's Come and Sing at 2 o'clock and then Choral Evensong at 4. And it'd be good to reproduce that volume and that intensity of singing that we heard during the service. The organ project has been an amazing piece of work. And the current fortnight of celebrations for me reflect how important that work is, not just in the restoration of this wonderful instrument, but in all the pieces of work that have gone on around it. So last week and next week, we'll be welcoming over 400 children to come in and spend a two-hour workshop with us, listening and learning about how an organ works. And I have to say, thanks to that, I now know how an organ works. Prior to that, I took it all for granted. It was there, it made a noise. It used to be asthmatic and sounded very wheezy every time it came on. And suddenly I now know why that was, and I understand how you make it work better. But they've had great fun, and that's thanks to a wonderful team of animateurs who've been with us all week. And there is a particular piece at the back of the church, the installation, which we're continuing to show through the coming week. And if you want to come in and find out how that amazing instrument works and have a go at learning how to play it, then at 5 o'clock on Monday evening, there is an open public session with Sarah, the artist, who will explain it to you and work with you to show you how you can get the most out of that amazing construction. So there's been the whole educational process. There's been engagement with our local schools and our community, which is thanks to the work of the Organ Project. There's also been an amazing bit of research going on. On Thursday night, we had a talk on the Boer War. And if you're wondering what that's got to do with the Organ Project, you have to go and look at the sign underneath the screen, which is dedicated in memory of those who died in the Boer War and some particular individuals. And it's a great pleasure to welcome those who are some descendants of those named on the screen and to have them with us today. But as well as the screen, our team of archivists and historians have been researching all sorts of wonderful things. We can now see, as you can see in the programme, the original receipts and invoices for the particular organ itself. They've discovered other bits about church history and all sorts of offshoots that are going to be looking at over the coming months. And so it's also been about us discovering and learning about our heritage. And the final piece of work has been that of just enjoying being together and celebrating music and art in our community and drawing people together to do that. So some of us yesterday shared in a Mojive dance. When I say shared, I was looking after the door, but the Lord Mayor and Lady Mayoress were doing a wonderful work of showing us how to do it, although the Lord Mayor did confess to me that it's no longer what he could do at the age of 17 when he could throw those he was driving with over his shoulder. He refrained himself yesterday. But it is about that sense of fun, that sense of enjoying what music and particularly this organ brings to this community, which we want to share with all around us. So it's been about all of those things, and that's what we also celebrate today. And all of that is thanks to the National Lottery Heritage Fund, for whom we owe an immense debt of gratitude. And now I say thank you to anyone I see buying a lottery ticket and tell them that they have paid for the restoration work here, and we're very grateful for it. But most of all, it's been about the restoration of the Walker organ. And that has been a fascinating project where I have also learnt about concert pitch and original pitch and all the different variations that lie in between and all the arguments for and against. And I could now bore you to death with that conversation, but I won't. I'm going to leave you to the experts who are going to demonstrate something of the project, something of the work that they've done, and also something of what is now here with us that we celebrate today. So I'm going to hand you over to Andrew Caskie from Nicholson's, who is hiding around the corner there, and he's going to be supported by some other people who he will introduce in just a moment.
I'm told by sign language that the projector is warming up. So in good faith, I will continue. Just to say hello, and my name is Andrew Caskie. I'm Managing Director of Nicholson Co, the organ building firm based in Malvern that we have had the privilege of restoring this wonderful organ. We've also had the privilege of getting to know the people here in St. Mary's Portsea, and I would like to start by thanking them for making it such a pleasure to work here. It's no secret among our staff that not all customers are the same, but it's virtually impossible to come to this church without having a cup of tea or coffee or chocolate biscuit or cake or all four pressed into your hand, and it makes it so much more special to be made to feel so welcome. So we'd like to say thank you very much to all the people here, Father Bob, to Brian, and to Rosie for all her hospitality, but especially I'd like to say thank you to Matt Dixon walking that way, because I don't think the project would have happened without him. Thanks. So before I tell you a little bit about the project, I'd also like to thank our team. It's a great privilege and joy to have so many colleagues here with me today. And I think that's also testament to how they were made to feel here in Portsea. And so I'd like to thank them for all their hard work. The project was led by Kevin Davies, and the tonal work was led by James Atherton, who we'll hear more from in a moment. I'm going to talk for about 10 minutes on the mechanical side of the project, why we did what we did, and the kind of nitty-gritty restoration work. And then I'm going to hand over to James, who is going to talk more about the tonal side. What makes this organ special, and what work has had to be done to bring back its original sound? And James is going to be doing that in collaboration with William McVicker. And William has been the consultant for the project, and we'd like to show our appreciation to him as well for all the input and encouragement and expertise that he has brought to the project. So, as you know, the organ was built by the London firm of J.W. Walker in 1889 and then completed in 1892, and it gave very good service until it was rebuilt in 1965 by the same firm. Now, the 60s were not a kind decade to Victorian organs. I think the way that we think of 1960s architecture now is what they thought of Victorian architecture in the 1960s. And it was very much ripe for improvement rather than ripe for retention and preservation. But actually, limited funds at the time were the saviour of this organ, because it meant that by the standards of the time, the work undertaken in 1965 was fairly kind. In saying that, it was still fairly substantial. And when we approached the organ in 2019 and were invited to tender for its restoration, there were a number of avenues that we could have done. Everybody agreed that the organ needed major work, but that could have just been restoration of the organ as found, so in other words, as rebuilt in 1965. Or we could have said, well, it was modernized then, let's continue that chapter further and modernize it once more and make it fit for the 21st century. Or we could have said, although the 1965 alterations were well-intentioned, they were a mistake, let's reverse them and put the organ back exactly as it was when new. And that would require quite a lot of conjectural reconstruction. In the end, we decided to do a bit of a mixture, an unusual compromise, and we've tried to put the organ back to how it was originally in almost every respect, but not with regard to the mechanism, in which we built a new mechanism that is more reliable, because there were many indications that the original action, that's what joins the keys to the valves under the pipes, weren't perhaps the most reliable. So it's been a bit of a mixture, very much historical with a degree of new construction. Now, one of the things that makes this organ special, this is obviously, as you can tell, a vast building, but this is not a vast organ. It's probably on the large side of medium, you might say. And it represents a very interesting opening chapter in an experiment by the Walker firm, what became a golden era for them in developing big organs that could really have a big sound, I should say, by not actually being enormous instruments of themselves. And that's done largely through the pipework. It's blown very hard compared to organs built, say, 20 years previously, and also some of the scale, the diameter of the pipework that was designed. And this became really the model for a number of instruments, such as Holy Trinity's Sloan Square in London, or St Matthew's Westminster, where Thomas Trotter plays, or Bristol Cathedral. There were quite a number of instruments that followed in the guise that was tested and proven here. Well, the first thing we have to do in restoring an organ is to take it to bits, which is a massive job. Every church is always amazed at the amount of stuff that comes out of a chamber, and it filled that whole side aisle and then some. And you can see here one of the many large reservoirs, big bellows, that contain the wind that the organ needs. And you can see the leather is in a bit of a state in there, so it wasn't holding much wind. Well, eventually, several lorry loads, we got everything back to our workshop in Malvern, and it's then a process of starting at the beginning of the pile and working our way through, putting it back into good condition. And that involves replacing much leather that perishes and cracks over the years, and then also repairing splits in woodwork that are meant to be windtight. Much of the organ pipes are, many of the organ pipes are mounted on very large wooden units we call soundboards. They have lots of internal wind divisions that are supposed to be windtight. But you can imagine with 130 years of the heating going on and off and on and off, there wasn't much that was windtight left in the soundboards. So they needed a lot of attention to get them right. There are some of the new actions being made. And these rather peculiar chimneys that extend the feet of the pipes. You can see here just a flavour of the detailed nature of the work. The work has taken around about 15,000 man hours, so a great deal of labour into the project. These are four of the largest pipes in the organ. The longer the pipe, the lower the note, and these are the ones that hadn't been out the organ since the organ was put in, but they all came out and came back to Malvern and were repaired, splits and so on. So they're all speaking now properly, exactly as they should have when new. One of the interesting things we had to do was to reconstruct some of the pipework. These pipes here with this funny little right-angled bend, which we call a hood, those were not how those pipes were originally. That was an alteration made in 1965. And we were briefed to put them back to how they were originally, which were these somewhat odd capped style with holes around it. They're nicknamed in the trade pepper pot for obvious reasons. And these were copied from a surviving Walker organ in Northampton to bring back the particular timbre of those pipes. They were still the same pipes, but they had been made to speak with a different accent from what they had originally. All the pipes had, and every part of the organ had to be thoroughly cleaned. There are some of the torpedo tubes outside. You can just see the scale of some of the pipework leaning against the factory in the sunshine there. Some of the pipes in the organ, when you watch Thomas playing later on, when his hands go onto the top keyboard, which we call the swell division of the instrument, all of the pipes controlled by that division are enclosed in a very large wooden box. And when I say large, I mean the size of your kitchen. You know, it's a small room, really. And the front face of that box is fitted with these louvres, like Venetian blinds. And the organist can open and close them with a rocker pedal, giving expression to the sound, hence the name of this division, the swell division. And there's some of the shutters being restored and made sound tight again. Lots of more leather work and repair. All the reservoirs, all the old leather was stripped off and replaced with new. One of the other things we did was to give the organ new lungs. Previously, the wind, the compressed air that the pipes are blown with, had been generated by a blower down in the cellar, directly below the organ, but the floor below us. And it was sucking in damp, cold air, which wasn't really helping the instrument. And so we have a brand new blower that is inside the organ and sucking in air from inside the chamber at the same temperature and humidity. Lots of new wind trunking required to repair previous alterations, and this was all made in the original style to what survived. One of the most significant changes for the player is the console. The console is like the desk where the player sits. And it has such an important part. It's the way that the organist should be able to hear the organ simply by looking at the console. And you should, before you play a note, you should be able to get an impression of what the organ should sound like. Now, this is a photograph, a very blurry, faint photograph of the original console that was replaced in 1965. It doesn't exist anymore. And the 1965 console was perfectly workmanlike, but it didn't sit right in terms of the atmosphere it created and the approach that it would give the player to the instrument. And so we've made a brand new console that is a replica of this photograph with details copied from other surviving Walker consoles elsewhere. And there it is in construction in the workshop. And then there is the finished version. Very unusual among organ consoles to have the draw stops in rows rather than columns. But I hope those of you who go up and see it later on will sense that it really gives the player the right kind of impression of the character of the instrument. One little touch, the original builder's plaque was missing. And Matt managed to find an original plaque on eBay for £20. The only problem was it was 1 year out. And so the one on the top, 1888, is an original that was found on the internet. And the one below we had made brand new as a copy and now sits proudly above the console. These are some what we call conveyances. These are metal tubes that feed the facade pipes. Right behind the pipes you can see. There are several thousand pipes in the organ. It's not just the ones you can see, but these are how the ones on the front are fed. And this is all new trunking. There are some of the actions being adjusted. Lots of setup time. I think some of the folks here wondered if we'd ever leave the church because it took so long to commission the organ. But there's a vast amount of setting up once the organ is all installed. And then the final stage is seeing all the pipes coming in. And there is just a couple of photographs illustrating the inside of the completed organ, showing just the extent of the pipework inside. So I hope that's been a quick quiz tour of the work that's been done. If you are interested in any more detail, there are lots more photographs on our website on the Portsea project page. But I'm now going to hand over to my colleagues, James Atherton and William McVicker, who are going to talk a little bit more about the tonal side of the work. Thank you.
Good afternoon. This has been an enormous privilege to restore the voice of this organ. When we first came to listen to the instrument, it was kind of notorious. People always talked about this organ, and we came to hear it. And my first impression was, I don't quite get what the fuss is about. And that's not to put down the organ at all, but it's actually the work that had happened since the organ was put in and by Walkers, both in 1965 and then in 1980 by Martin of Oxford, had taken the tonal sound away from its roots. And it just had a sort of a feeling of an organ that wasn't quite at ease with itself. And so the main thing that we wanted to do, because we couldn't, as Andrew has just described, completely restore the action of the organ, take it back to how Walker's originally built it. The one thing we could sort of hang our hat on, if you like, was to restore the sound, to get the sound back of this instrument. But that wasn't a very easy thing to do because of the nature of some of the work that had happened in the past. So some of the pipes had had alterations done to them. I won't go into too much technical detail, but they'd been sort of, you know, in a term we've got a phrase called sort of fiddled with. And they tried to get a sort of, in 1965, a fresher sound to the organ. But of course, the roots of this organ are in, you know, it's a hymn machine, really, which is why it doesn't have a lot of stops. As Andrew was saying, it's basically designed to accompany the choir. It's designed for hymnody. And that really was the purpose of it. It wasn't meant to be a recital instrument. And in 1965, a lot of organs of that period, up into the sort of, really up into the 80s, there was a feeling that actually what was wanted was an organ that could play repertoire. And luckily, as Andrew said, there wasn't enough money here in 1965 to actually do the sort of alterations that perhaps might have happened to it. So we were very fortunate that actually we had the raw material to take it back. What we did have to find was examples of how we think this organ would originally have sounded. And the thing about about this period of organ building for walkers was they were experimenting. They were in a transition period. So the Victorian sound was quite bright chorus work, and I'll explain in detail about chorus work in a minute, and William explain about how the balances were set out. And walkers were still using scales from the Victorian period. However, with an enormous church like this, they knew that what they needed to do was to produce breadth, you know, real sort of quality and width in the sound. And the way that they did that was increasing the scales. That's the sort of the width of the pipe. So if you look at the pipes in the front, for instance, right above where William's sitting, that's the base of the open diapason number one. Now, the scale of the bottom of that is almost the same as a pipe that would be twice its length. And the idea really was to get huge tone down here. And Andrew was just saying to me before, when we were singing the hymns, and actually when Brian was playing his voluntary, when he pulls that open diapason number one on, it's like a massive big hug. It's sort of, you know, and it's that sort of sound that drives a congregation. It's not mixtures, it's not spiky reeds and any of that kind of stuff. It's warmth, it's breadth. And this was the idea here. And walkers had this thing where they had enormous basses. They hadn't worked out where they were going with it all. So they had these big basses, and all of a sudden, within an octave, they halved, and then they went back to a scale which was more sort of in the Victorian style. And so we were sort of, what we had to do really was to sort of reestablish this, what William calls tonal massing. Everything's sort of, you know, everything's got a sort of a place in the chorus. And I'll just ask William to just demonstrate one or two things now. He can probably describe better from the organ this idea of tonal massing and what walkers were trying to do. So over to you, William.
Yeah, thank you very much, James. You've already heard from Andrew and from James, and indeed from Father Bob, that this is a special organ. And what I'm going to try and do is demonstrate why it is special, fairly briefly. And there are two ways of trying to unpick this in terms of how we restore the organ. The first one is through James's expert detailed analysis of what he found in the pipes themselves. There's a certain amount of detective work and looking at other examples and seeing how things were changed and how they might go back. And the other one is to do with getting under the skin of the Victorians in that 1880s period and having a bit of historical insight into what was going on. And I'm just going to try and illustrate this before demonstrating a few sounds to see if it helps give you a context. So the 1880s were a period of real exploration in terms of organ sonorities. There are quite a few developments made by different organ builders, and one of the reasons for those developments was that the idea of hand pumping organs was becoming a thing of the past, and it was possible then to use hydraulic power, water engines, or to have gas engines. Electricity came a little bit later, but the invention of the hydraulic and the gas engines meant that it was possible to get higher wind pressures for organ pipes. Now, in 1885, there was the Great Inventions Exhibition in central London. And one organ builder, Henry Bryson, the Bryson brothers, exhibited a foghorn, which was a giant organ pipe blown on very heavy pressure, and which he tried to sell to the Navy as a new foghorn device. I'm not sure he quite succeeded, but what he probably did was manipulate organ pipes to be able to be blown on very heavy pressure. And at the same time, the great organ builder William Hill and Son had been contracted to build the biggest organ in the world for Sydney Town Hall. And that was being built in London in the middle and the back end of the 1880s. And so they were able to harness this new technology to be able to produce pipes of a very big full tone using higher wind pressures. And I think, I'm making a supposition now, but it's my belief that Walkers saw what was going on and tried to put their own stamp on the Victorian sounds that they had already received through history. So in 1871, Henry Willis, another great London organ builder, had produced a huge organ for the Royal Albert Hall, but it was generally considered to be underpowered for the building, despite the fact that it had 100 stops or so. And you were told a little bit earlier by Andrew that this was a sort of biggish, medium-sized organ, and yet it produces a big tone. So when Walkers exhibited at the 1885 Inventions Exhibition, they produced an organ with three open diapasons. Now, I'm getting a bit organological now, so you'll have to bear with me. If you look at your programme and have a look at Thomas Trotter's biography, you can read that later, but you turn to the next page where it says the organ specification, you will see there that it says stops number 2, 3, and 4, open diapason, large, medium, and small. Now, the habit of Victorian organists was to play the open diapasons of the organ all together, but not three of them at once. And this was the new thing that Walkers took to the 1885 Inventions Exhibition. And after that exhibition, the church here bought an, or ordered a new organ by Walker, and they built a sort of replica of the instrument that they'd made for the 1885 Inventions Exhibition. So it was a new kind of idea. The original organ for the exhibition was sold to a concert hall in London, then moved to Ipswich, and then destroyed in the Second World War. So we can't see that one anymore. But I'm just going to talk you through what this great big hug that James has described to you. So I'll do this with one finger and one thumb on the organ. But first of all, I'm going to play the small open diapason. Here we go. And then I'm going to add the medium diapason. And then I'm going to add the large diapason. I'm going to put my microphone down now. Now that's that great big Victorian hug that James was talking about, but they put a slightly different spin on it because they managed to put into the pedals some really, really deep, low, soft notes. So here they are. You can probably feel that through the floor. And then if I put stops number 1, 2, 3, and 4 together with these pedal notes, and I will play a sonority to you which would have been absolutely new in the Victorian period, and one which I think would have taken their breath away. To us now, all organs sound a bit the same, but at this period they managed to harness all these technical inventions and produce an organ sonority the like of which had not been heard before. Here it is. Thank you. Now that's what I would call a kind of Bourneville chocolate of an organ. It's got all of the, that's only four stops on the organ and three in the pedal, and it really, it's the backbone for the instrument. And of course, Walker's came out of Victorian organ building, which was essentially classical in nature. It stretched, actually, that Walker firm stretched back well before the 1850s into the first half of the 19th century. And if I build up a chorus, I'm going to put these stops together and build up this giant-sized classical English chorus of the 1890s. Here we go. I'm going to mass the stops together slowly on the great organ over here and just complete that sonority for you. Two mixtures, stops number 10 and then 11. So there's our classical backbone of the organ, underpinned by the Bourneville chocolate foundation tone. And I think, James, do you want to say something about what we discovered when the organ came apart? Because the way those pipes were made, some of them was actually quite surprising.
Yeah, that's right, William. You've seen organ pipes before. You can see the ones here that they've got a, what we call a mouth. And it's got a top lip and a bottom lip, and a lot of diapason pipes have got what we call flatting, which is the bit that you can see above the opening for the mouth. When we took this organ to pieces, we discovered that the double diapason on the grate and the number two diapason on the grate both had the construction almost of flutes, so they had no flatting, they were completely sort of cylindrical all the way down to the mouth. With what's called very deep nicking, but because the mouth was quite narrow, the cutter was reasonably high and they were blown hard, it gives this really sort of harmonically interesting sound. And actually the open diapason 2 was made of what's called spotted metal, which has got lead and tin in it. It's about 50% of each, and it's called spotted because when you cast it on the bench, as it cools down, it forms these little spots, and basically the tin and the lead try to separate. And so, you know, it curdles, for want of a better word, I suppose. And so we discovered that they'd use this material to get this, but to get this sort of brightness of sound, but a different construction. We haven't seen this in any other organs anywhere. And this was part of the nature of the sort of experimenting that Walkers were doing. And as you heard before, the classical chords, those of you who are organists in here will understand what we're talking about, with these brilliant mixtures on the top. And it's really interesting because in 1965, what they were trying to do here was to kind of get this brilliant classical sound, but it already has this brilliant classical sound. It was built in. And so we can't quite, but what they did do was they altered the reed sounds, and perhaps we'll move on to those in a second. So what we found was that the reeds had been structurally altered. As Andrew showed you before, there was some what we call, there was hooded pipes. Now this organ never had hooded pipes. All the resonators were straight or capped. And we've got several different styles of reeds in the organ. Now the reed, if you think of, for those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, reeds, most organ pipes in the organ look a bit like that. And you see some of the back, you see some different ones at the back, you know, wooden ones with stoppers in and all that kind of stuff. I won't go into detail about those, but the reed stops are working on a mechanical basis, and they've got a little brass, what we call a tong, and then they vibrate onto a shallot, and then they're tuned using a spring, and if you knock the spring down, the note goes higher. If you knock it up, the note goes lower. That's the basic sort of premise. If you can imagine a clarinet, it's that sort of principle. So the wind goes between the reed and the shallot, and it beats. Now, luckily, the shallots were not too badly altered. There was a fashion in that period that we call, they opened the shallots up. And actually, they didn't do that here. One or two of the tongs were changed, but on the whole, we actually had the basic raw material to take the sound back. But what had been changed were the resonators, and the resonator determines the sort of sound that the reed makes. So an oboe has got a particular resonator, a clarinet has got a particular resonator, a trumpet, a horn, they've all got their own sort of particular styles. And in the quest to get sort of more bright reed tone, they put what's called harmonic resonators into the reeds. Into the mix, if you like, and a harmonic resonator is double the length. But actually, in real terms, what that does, it makes it louder in terms of reed sound at the top of the keyboard, but actually it thickens the tone out a little bit. And now these organs, the Victorian style really was that the reeds tailed off as it went into the treble, and the flue work and the upper work actually got louder. And so that as one sort of tails off, the other one sort of comes up. And this organ is a perfect example of what's called voice-led voicing. Because it was meant for hymnody, every stop has got a crescendo. So you start at the bottom, and some of the stops start crescendoing basically as soon as you start at the bottom. Some of them, depending on the role that they have, start their crescendo somewhere else. But getting the reed tone back meant actually taking away the reed dominance in the top of the keyboard. So we had to make new straight resonators for the horn and for the trombone. So the stops that you saw back before there with the hoods on, that was the pedal trombone. They've now got straight resonators. But the great trumpet we had to remake into what's called pepper pot. And the later Walker organs, William just mentioned that this sort of Bourneville chocolate sort of sound. The later Walker organs, their reeds were really chocolatey, and you know, they came on without much. They sort of changed the colour, but they didn't really come on with a lot of eclat, if you like. But the way that they made their shallot, which is the business end of the reed, they were still very classical, what they were doing. So the tone came in a little bit, but not too much. And so if you listen to, instance, for the swell horn, that's actually a really bright sound, even though the word horn tends to you think of a sort of an orchestral instrument with a covered dark sound. But actually, it's not that at all. It's quite bright. So, William, would you just play a couple of chords or notes on the horn?
Yeah, this is a little excerpt, just a few bars from a piece by Hopkins, in which the horn stop really acts as an accompanimental sound to two great flutes. Here we go.
Thank you. You can hear the quality of tone in the horn. It's got I talk about vowel sounds when I'm doing voicing, particularly with reeds. And the sort of the Victorian style of reed voicing had a wide vowel, it's not quite French, but it's sort of an sort of vowel rather than oh. So you know as the Walkers progressed, their reed tone started going from ah to oh, and they're quite sort of covered. But actually, these have got quite a nice sort of broad sort of ah vowel to them. So they're quite sort of brilliant when they're coming on with the flue work. But because the mixtures are so bright, actually they don't come on with a bang. They really sort of add excitement to everything else. Now the great trumpet we were expecting when we put the pepper pots on it, but actually that to dull the sound down. And it wasn't something that perhaps we would have liked to have done, but it was the right thing to do. However, it's not dull in any way at all. It's really quite bright. So William, perhaps just play something on the... So that's still quite a classical sound, but it's starting to get a bit more refined, and this is what the pepper pot does. It sort of chokes it off at the top, but then you open it up with these little pepper pots, and they've got little what's called a tong to sort of regulate them. And you'll have seen, I don't know how this clicker works, but they've got, it looks like a little sort of an eye and a mouth, and they, for all the world, they look like Beaker from the Muppets. And I was tuning the organ just before, just after Thomas finished, and I was sort of reaching over to get to sort of part of the 16-foot reed, and I was just aware that I was being watched. And these pipes have got little eyes and a little sort of mouth on them. But actually, like, going back to the tonality, it's actually still quite classical. They've not yet gone to that sort of chocolate box sort of sound. Now, the oboe was a relatively easy fix to take back to how that was, but the clarinet really was a real conundrum for us, because it had been revoiced in 1965, it had been altered, but what we didn't know was actually what had been altered from. And because this is such a unique organ of its period, actually we didn't have another organ to go back to with a clarinet that was exactly the same. And in the end, after quite a lot of discussion, and I mean a lot of discussion, we decided to leave it as we found it. So it had been revoiced in 1965, but it's a really beautiful stop. It's got lots of character to it, and they didn't try and make it too chocolatey. It would have been a little bit more classical. So, and we've kept some of that tonality back in there, but because the original organ was going to have a solo organ with more orchestral sounds on it, and because the money was never found available, in fact, in the original picture, I think you might have a picture of the console in your book, you'll notice that the fourth keyboard is actually used to store hymn books, because you know it never happened. We couldn't work out whereabouts in the organ that solo organ would have been, because we did consider actually replacing or making a new solo organ with that specification. But because we couldn't say for sure where it was going to go, we didn't do it. So we kept one orchestral colour on the organ, that's the clarinet. So William, would you like to just play a couple of notes on that?
On the clarinet?
Yeah. Lovely sound, isn't it? It's beautiful. So the other reed was the trombone that we took the sound back to how that was. Now the bottom 12 notes of the three 16-foot reeds on the organ had what's called leathered shallots. So the face of the shallot has got leather put on it, and the idea for that is actually to give a little bit more solidity in the tone. But because the shallots are what are called open, actually it doesn't. Again, with this chocolate sound we keep talking about, actually in the trombone it doesn't have that sound at all. And we did worry again about putting the leather back in the shallots. Would that ruin the characteristic of that sort of growling grittiness that you want in 16-foot reeds? However, it didn't. So if you'd like to just play a few notes in the trombone. The trombone's one of these sort of Goldilocks stops. It's not too loud, not too soft, it's just right. And for whatever you want to use it for, it's right there, it's perfect. We could go on. There's one more thing I'd like you to hear, and that's the softest sound on the organ. Now, at York Minster, Harrison's, our friends in Durham, have just done a magnificent restoration of the organ there. And they've got a stop on the solo organ called Echo Dulciana. And Francis Jackson used to say that it was a fortissimo pianissimo. And it just completely disappears to nothing. Well, we've got one here. I think it's better. But Just play the Dulciana with a box completely closed. Can you hear that? Isn't that magnificent? And that rank of pipes is on 6 inches of wind. And so to try and regulate that stop and to get it back down, because it had been opened up to try and make it louder, to try and get that back was quite a job, actually. And there's one stop that goes with it called the Vox Angelica, the voice of an angel. And it's the most beguiling sound you've ever heard in your life. It's beautiful. Thank you. 32 purring underneath. I think I've said enough. I could probably talk for hours about this instrument because it is one of the most remarkable organs I've had the pleasure to work on. And to restore the voice of this instrument has really been an enormous honour, a privilege, a joy, and to, you know, to get the pipes back into the building and to start hearing it breathe and sing and hear and paying due diligence to the work the walkers were doing and to get inside their mindset of what they were trying to do. They were on a journey, though this wasn't the finished article. They just basically started their journey, and we've joined them on that journey. And you know, along with the console that Darren's made, which if you do get a chance to go upstairs, I mean, it's one of the most beautiful pieces of organ furniture you'll ever see in your life. And the attention to detail is remarkable. And you sit at that console and you know that it's going to make the sound that it does. So anyway, that's enough from me. William, have you got anything more you'd like to say?
No, I think it's time almost to hear our star of the evening.
There we go. Thank you very much.
Andrew, when he spoke, very kindly thanked us for our hospitality. I think you've now experienced why we were so keen to offer that hospitality, because of the commitment, the passion, the understanding, the wisdom, the dedication, and the craft of the Nicholson's team. It was a real pleasure to have around, and we're going to miss them dearly. I've said we need to find something else that we can get for you to do, but sadly I don't have another Nicholson's organ that we can kind of play with, but one day we'll work with you again. But can we give that whole team a huge thank you? And their passion and dedication, et cetera, is matched by that of Dr. William McVicker. We were chatting just beforehand, and he joined the pre-organ project work, which we think goes back to 2009, when we began to think about doing something. But it's been William's constant presence and guidance and wisdom, for which we are also very grateful. Thank you to William. And locally, we have been richly blessed by an army of volunteers. I've lost count of how many. But they have done most amazing things and have covered every age. So we've had our young junior members from the choir, particularly Harry and Olivia today, welcoming people, the junior choir getting involved in all sorts of ways, right the way through the age range to those of us who might be described as slightly older. And they have committed themselves to history, to welcoming, to doing all sorts of amazing things. The last week, I don't think Adrienne has left the building, as she has helped and supported the various workshops, the food being served. So can we give our volunteers, and particularly Adrienne, a huge round of applause? And they in turn have been supported by the wonderful organ project team. You heard Brian playing for the service. He's been working as our link to schools and education. We've had Catherine, who's been marshalling, encouraging and enthusing our volunteers, and we've had Pip, who's been covering our PR and media. And they have been a great team, for which we again owe a huge vote of thanks. Thank you to them for all their work. However, Andrew stole my thunder a little bit, for which I'll forgive him, but there is only one person without which none of this would have happened. One person who has pulled it together, who's driven it, who's been at the heart of it all, who's been constantly around, whether it's watching over the organ builders, welcoming people in for project work, being here all week with the education workshops, but really just making it possible, putting the bid together and making sure we could hit all our targets and outputs and outcomes and all those things that my mind just goes, well. He has been the person for whom we owe the most thanks. And Matt, if you'd like to come to the front, I've got a small gift for you on behalf of the organ project. So thank you to Matt.
What a wonderful treat we've been given. We've heard so much through the enthusiasm and love for craft. Beautiful. I think there's one other thank you on behalf of you all to Bob. Every community needs a cheerer honour. And Bob is that writ large. So without any more ado, we've had a wonderful afternoon. I think there's more to come. But Bob, we want to express our thanks for your gentle leadership in this place. We appreciate you. Thank you.
As the Bishop just said, there is more to come. So we're now going to enjoy listening to the restored organ in the hands of Thomas Trotter, giving us a recital, the programme for which is also in your programme. And there will be an interval. And during the interval, there will be drinks served by the south porch door. I'm not sure if it's warmer or colder outside, but there is a breeze. So if you want to just have a little stretch and a walk around for 10 minutes, quarter out the interval, then come and get a drink and enjoy that. And if you want to ask any of us who stood up and said things today, any questions at all, we'll be around. And likewise, at the end of the recital, there'll be people around who'll be happy to show you upstairs, talk to you about what the project has been, etc. So we're looking forward to handing you over to Thomas Trotter, who I think is upstairs and ready.
Thank you. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's such a pleasure to be playing here this afternoon. Some of you will have noticed that I played the organ for the last inauguration in 1981 when it was restored. Of course, I was extremely young then, just out of short trousers. Anyway, it was a great event for me, as is this afternoon. On that occasion, I began with Bach's Prelude and Fugue in G, and I thought it would be a nice touch of symmetry to begin this concert with that same piece. Most of the rest of the programme contains music that was written roughly around the time that this organ was installed, sort of 1890s, 1880s. This year is a big year for César Franck because it's the 200th anniversary of his birth. He was very important in the organ world. He's sometimes called the father of French romantic organ music because he was really the first composer to realize the musical possibilities of the new romantic organs by Cavaillé-Coll. Franck was organist at Saint Clotilde, and he called that organ his orchestra, and it was to be the inspiration for so many organ pieces that are treasured by organists today. Perhaps the best known of them is the one I'm going to play now, the Prelude, Fugue, and Variation. The Prelude features a theme which is played on the swell oboe. And then that same theme comes back in the variation, completely unchanged. The variation element is provided by the accompaniment, which is much more elaborate. And I'm going to play it on the harmonic flute. And in between comes a rather somber fugue. Franck trained as a virtuoso pianist before he became an organist. And I like to think of this piece as displaying his different personalities, organist in the fugue and pianist in the prelude and the variation.
Thank you.
While César Franck was playing at Saint-Clotilde, Charles-Marie Vidor was playing at the very fashionable and affluent Church of Saint-Sulpice just down the road. His organ was also a cavaille-corps, this one of the largest ones ever built, some 5 manuals and 100 stops. And that organ too was to be the inspiration for Vidor's 10 solo organ symphonies. Now, everybody knows the toccata from the 5th symphony, to which many a bride has tripped down the aisle. But in some ways, the first movement is rather more musically interesting and certainly more substantial. It begins as a theme and variation, which is played as staccato chords. It starts like this. Quite hard playing it with one hand. And then it continues with 4 continuous variations, in which you'll have a chance to hear some of the different stop combinations on this organ. Then there's a passage in the major key. It's kind of like a hymn, kind of slow chorale. And then that theme returns, and it becomes much more like a fantasy and very exciting. And there's a great build-up, and finally that theme comes back, played in octaves in the pedals. It's a great standalone piece. It lasts about 10 minutes.
Thank you.
That was music by W.T. Best, who was the greatest concert hall organist of the 19th century. He was organist at St. George's Hall, Liverpool, for over 40 years. Vaughan Williams was an agnostic, but that didn't stop him from writing some beautiful church music. And in 1907, he edited the English hymnal and included these three Welsh tunes. They were published for the first time in that hymnal. Then 20 years later, he decided to make three chorale preludes out of those tunes for organ. And they work really well as a set, and they're so well suited to this kind of instrument. They sound absolutely superb. The first one is treated like an improvisation, so you only really hear snippets of the tune and then some little cascades of notes in between. The second prelude, there are two verses. In the first verse, you'll hear the tune in the tenor. And then in the second verse, it becomes more animated and the tune moves up to the treble. The final one, Havridol, is slightly unusual in that it's all written for the white keys. So I don't have to play any of those black keys. They're a bit pesky. They always get in the way anyway. And you'll hear the full majesty of the organ just building up from the start to the finish.
Thank you.
I'm going to finish with two arrangements of orchestral music as a kind of affectionate nod to the Platinum Jubilee celebrations. When this organ was built, playing orchestral arrangements on the organ was all the rage. In fact, I was looking in the program booklet at Dr. George Martin's opening concert in 1892, and nearly all of the pieces were arrangements. When I compared that with my program in 1981, there were no arrangements at all. That's not because I didn't want to play them, but it would have done serious damage to my street cred had I programmed them on that occasion. Then 2 years later, I was appointed city organist in Birmingham, where there is a big tradition of playing transcriptions, so I had a legitimate reason from that time onwards to start playing them. Ronald Binge, which is a wonderful name, he was a very successful composer of light music during the 1940s and 50s, and many of his tunes were used as television and radio theme tunes. Sailing By, for example, is heard every night on the shipping forecast on Radio 4. This piece, Elizabethan Serenade, started life as an andante cantabile, which I think is a bit boring. And then a year later, when Princess Elizabeth became queen, he changed it to Elizabethan Serenade, which I think is much more interesting. Eric Coates started his career as a distinguished viola player, but he had to give that up because he was injured, and thereafter he devoted himself to composing and conducting his own light music. He wrote many marches, but I think this one is most uplifting and optimistic. It's the third movement of a suite called the Three Elizabeth Suites. Each movement is inspired by a particular generation of Elizabeth. This one, of course, Princess Elizabeth to become the Queen. I feel it's like a soundtrack of the early life of Princess Elizabeth.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to add my thanks and congratulations, first of all, to Matt Dixon for his amazing work in getting this project through. I don't think it would ever have happened without him. Dr. William McVicker for all of his wonderful, wise advice. Andrew Caskie, James Atherton, and of course the wonderful team at Nicholson's. This organ is, it's been magnificently restored. I do remember it from 1981, but I never remember it as being as good as this. It's a truly authentic Victorian sound, and so opulent and beautifully blended. I think it's one of the best organs of this period that I've ever played. So many congratulations to Nicholson's. Before I play my encore, just to let you know, this is a shameless advert. I've recorded some of the music that I played in this concert, and it's a bit of a coincidence, but I do have some CDs with me, and you'd be very welcome to buy them. Now, on the subject of Platinum Jubilee, it was such a wonderful occasion in June, and I'd like to prolong that a little bit by playing you another march. This one is normally played on the last night of the proms on the BBC. Well, they had the first night last night, so they're getting the last night tonight. It's the Pomp and Circumstance March number 1 by Elgar.
behalf of all you thank Thomas for that wonderful performance and a wonderful recital which has drawn to an end our day of celebration. You have been told there are some other opportunities. Just to remind you, in case you've forgotten what they are, Monday night at 5 o'clock, a chance to come and experience the pipe organ at the other end of the building with Sarah the artist. Tomorrow afternoon, come and sing at 2 o'clock, choral evensong as a consequence at 4 o'clock, and then next Saturday at 7:30, the Portsmouth Choral Union are having a concert involving the use of the restored organ. And then on the 5th of August, if you want to hear another organ recital, 7:30, we'll be delighted to be welcoming back Adrian Bawtry as our recitalist. This afternoon has been free and is our gift to everyone to celebrate together. However, we have a slight problem that we're £15,000 under the final amount we need to raise. And if you'd like to make a donation or a thanksgiving as you leave, then there are plates at the door. If, as most of us do, you no longer carry cash, there is a card machine ready and set up to go and will take donations up to the value of £1,000. So, Lord Mayor, we are delighted to have you with us today. But seriously, if you'd like to make a donation, please do, or you can do it online, and there are booklets and information leaflets about the project and the things that you can engage with as we move forward. Thank you all for being here, and enjoy the rest of a very warm evening. Thank you.